So, I think you know who this guy is.
Bradley. Hey, Bradley.
I'm Tom. I mix the dialogue and music. And
I'm Jason on music editing and recording.
Dean Zupancic, sound effects.
Richard King, sound designer.
All right, so we look at our first clip.
You got him, boy!
That became MOS. After the curtain was, after he says, "You got him, boy," because in order to get the timing right of the camera movement, we played the timpani on set, on the waterfront, always knowing that we were going to have to create all those sounds in post. So we didn't get any of that. The slapping of his butt, the sound on the bed, his feet landing on the floor, that all was, we created all of that because it was all MOS because we needed the sound on the set of the movie, of the song, so we knew that we were going to be able to time it properly. So that was really about being able to create it, make it believable, and also always wanting the natural sound of the world to be musically in line with what was happening rhythmically. So the movie telling us that in a very overt way by him literally pounding it to the beat of the score. So that was the first magical, realistic moment I wanted us to experience. Like, oh, okay. And then wanting, you know, how many times we really worked, and what's the sound of that? You know, because he jumps and then he lands the little ladder, and he lands. You know, we working on what is the sound of that? What is the door? What is the sound of the door opening and closing? You know, these are all things that we spent like an enormous amount of time on.
And then the discussion of either playing mono or going straight Atmos, even though the picture is...
Right, the discussion of the eras.
Right.
On the film, playing kind of the film in the style of...
Oh, that,
you know,
I mean, that was
40s.
A macro conversation.
Right, right, right.
You know, I fell in love with the sound of the camera because we shot black and white film. So we early on played with, like, what if we build in the sound of the film going through the camera? Because many scenes, we had to take that out because you heard the film running right through the camera, which I kind of fell in love with, but in the end, I would thank God we did take it out because it actually got in the way.
Yeah.
But there was months there where, you know, which again, I love all of us. There's no bad idea. You pursue everything. I mean, we worked on A Star Is Born. Jason had the most incredible score, do you remember this? That he made, that he composed, that we didn't use. And he spent weeks on it. And it's like, you remember?
Yeah.
And it was like, and there's just, you know, there's never a bad idea. And when you've been in the trenches together for as long as we have, we going back to American Sniper, you know, it's just beautiful. And so it's like, there's nothing better to see like, oh, I don't know how far down that is. Everybody ready to die? And we just do it. And we come up with things that are very inspiring. Like, for example, the story of wind in the movie and how that evolved. The story of the birds and how that evolved. You know, there's so many things. The story of audiences. You know, this was a huge storytelling point. The just smattering of applause, as he's called in there. You're like, oh, they're not very happy that he's going to do it. And then the fact that what they just witnessed was daunting. So they're laughing. You know, I wanted them to be laughing more than cheering because they kind of didn't understand what just happened. You know, it was on the cover of the New York Times the next day, but this guy who was 25 years old just came in and blew everybody's mind.
Yeah.
And so I wanted, and then Bruno Zerato was like sort of explaining it to everybody. And the sound that I love is like people don't quite understand what's happening. It's like watching early Richard Pryor. And people aren't necessarily laughing. Do you know what I mean? They're kind of like, what's going on? Something new is happening. And so that was a huge thing that, you know, that we spent a lot of, I mean, I just look back at that. How much time we just spent on, what is that, 3 minutes?
Yeah.
Sonically is just, it's crazy.
I think one of the things I love about that little clip we just looked at is that it is really the introduction of the music playing a character in the movie.
And
that's, you know, the butt slap into that is sort of that, you know, symbolic transition of that. And the way the music is played in this movie, by and large, is not typical. You know, we don't play it like, you know, this underscore thing that's
sneaking in. No,
there is
no score,
really.
Yeah, it's all character.
We talked about the movie.
It's all needle drops. There is no score in the movie. There's not one piece of score.
Right.
Yeah.
But it's like the movie is the score to the music.
That's right.
So it's a little bit, you know, reverse thinking about it. And
to the point of like needle drops, because literally there is not like, we didn't take a scene and then have a composer look at it and score. No, these are pieces of music that the movie is sort of feeding.
Yeah. And, you know, to sort of emphasize the experience of that audience watching him come out and whatever, you know, we had to go and record all this score, you know, again, in order to have this sort of big immersive feel and really put you in it.
Like, yeah, I mean, that there's another example, because in the movie, I don't know if everybody's seen the film, but there's a Mahler's Resurrection that Leonard Bernstein conducts, and we recorded that live, so we have this incredible sound. And we also did the choral rehearsal for Make Our Garden Grow live. And early on, we loved the idea of using the recordings of Bernstein.
Right.
But as we were in the mixing stage, we realized it just didn't have the same breath and body. So we then went and we recorded all of this, except for Adagietto.
Yeah.
Because we just couldn't actually match what was done in Adagietto, and you just sweetened it.
Yeah, I mean, we really didn't use any like film scoring techniques either, like where we just striped pieces of the orchestra where you would, you know, typical conventional film scoring. We wanted to really lean on the classical world for, you know, this immersive type of quality for a recording, you know, that was more authentic to Lenny and the recordings we were used to.
And that's when we went to London with the London Symphony Orchestra and did all of it over the course of 2 days, was it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Two or three, yeah.
Can you imagine anyone else scoring a movie about Leonard Bernstein?
No.
Might have been a daunting task.
No, yeah. I mean, that's also one of my favorite. The moment that keeps making me cry in the movie is when we see actually Leonard Bernstein at the end is conducting, and we're hearing psalms. And then it says music by Leonard Bernstein, because most people won't even know that what they have just been witness to is all of his music for the most part. The other thing I would just say about that is that was complicated in terms of the timing and the movement, the cinematic movement of that sequence was finding the right place to put the voiceover of the guy announcing it so that we heard the amount of information we needed to understand without it getting away from the music. And where he was and being able to hear his breath. I mean, the rhythmic timing of all that took a lot of work from all of us for you know, testing it out and trying it and having that voiceover stop midway through the walk. Exactly. Remember, it had a lot of iterations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I just love so many of the transitions in this movie, and we're going to look at a few of them, but this has several of them where we're kind of going in, you know, he runs out, then we're walking in with him. Like you said, that radio announcer, at first you're kind of like, well, am I supposed to be hearing him? And then you get the right words you're supposed to hear. And then, you know, you settle with him and he comes out and it goes totally quiet as he goes to, you know.
And the other thing is breathing is a major part of this movie. Huge, huge story point, sonically. And the movie starts with him sort of alone and the phone's ringing, which you didn't see. And then he takes this phone call and he's breathing heavily and he's lighting the cigarette. And then, you know, I want to be able to, with this cacophony of noise and the voice, the announcer and the music, then all of a sudden you're with him just breathing. And then he walks out and you're in this huge Carnegie Hall. And then also, and he turns the pages. I love hearing the score turned. And then you're hearing his breath again. And then that plays throughout the whole movie, where you hopefully feel very private in this epic world. And that's why at the very end, and the whole movie is about the two of them, he and his wife, you're just with them breathing together in bed. That's their final moments. They're not talking. They're just, you're hearing the music of their breaths together.
This, I think, you know, one of the things that was a challenge in this movie was that we have this scope of super intimate stuff. I mean, you know, the performances are amazing, and there's such a delicacy to what's going on. It's, you know, it's hard to get in there and support that and not have a bunch of noise, not have a bunch of unnatural sounding things, and just get all of the little elements of the performances to come out and read and make us feel close to the characters when they're close. And then on the other end, we have these moments where there's giant scope of the performances, you know, leading up to the Ely Cathedral scene, which we'll look at eventually. And, you know, even in this, some big pieces of music that give us the size and the feeling of, you know, how big of a character Lenny really is.
To that point, the other thing is, you know, every sound mix of every movie is one musical element, really, right? But we started to talk about this during the mixing of A Star Is Born, when I knew that it looked like we were going to do this movie, that it actually is going to be one musical element. Like, actually.
Yeah. You're right.
Like, the movie's rhythm is symphonic. And so this dynamic range that you're speaking of is so key, mm-hmm. because it is a part of this symphonic arrangement.
Yeah.
You know, which is what the movie is and is guided by.
Yeah.
It's guided, the propulsion of the movie is this symphonic movement.
Yeah. And I think his music too has this level of dynamics.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For years we were having the discussion, how do we get through the editing process and these music choices without cutting up Lenny's music? You know, like, which that opens up a big can of worms. Like, how do you know, Bradley had the daunting task in picture editing and everything, like how to just the sequence like we just watched. How do you actually tie that sequence together without chopping the music up and sort of destroying it, which I think is one of the beautiful things of the film. The music's not cut up and, you know, looped and things like that. So we found masters when we went into shooting that we liked, that we thought were kind of the prize choices after digging through all of them. And Yannick actually brought a lot to that. I mean, we opted not to use click tracks, which to keep it even more authentic to Lenny. And Yannick was the most impressive conductor I've ever witnessed in my life. I mean, we could play him a sequence, you know, because we'd been in post sort of editing with masters, and Yannick could map that stuff. I've never seen like a mapping memory brain thing that Yannick
and
could
quickly.
Carry. And quick, yeah. Because we were constantly making changes to the film, and I'd show Yannick quick times of kind of what we had and where the picture cuts were, and there were no clicks. We were trying to map and chase. He was that good at sort of timing.
All right, so I'm going to play two clips kind of back to back.
I miss her terribly. Hello? Yes. Of course.
The reason why I played the little first clip is because we're going from color to black and white, and it's an absolute, sound-wise, it's an absolutely seamless transition. And then the same thing is happening in the next clip, you know, at the beginning of that, where we're going from black and white to color. And, you know, visually, that's a pretty drastic change. but the sound is making it, you know, seamless. And it's gluing together, you know, that this is Lenny telling us, you know, and connecting his older self at the beginning of the movie to his younger self and that unfolding. And I just think that was, you know, there's a lot of great transitions in the movie, but those are kind of ones I wanted to highlight because the sound is really doing sort of an opposite thing to the picture in terms of.
Well, it's not. We were so adamant about was like it not getting in the way of the picture, really, because you have this. So we're about to break into this 1:3:3 aspect ratio, and that's why we're shooting the proscenium of the other room. The last shot of the color, even though it's 1:8:5, is almost as if it's getting ready for the 1:3:3, and then we go from that to a black with a window that's outlined in almost that 1:3:3, and that visual transition is what we wanted everybody to focus on. And, you know, we dealt with this a lot. There was just the slightest.
We worked on that transition a lot.
A lot, you know, because, there, you know, just because, you know, the slightest sonic shift, then all of a sudden you're really not visually completely in tune. You're also sonically adjusting and that it's not fluid and it's not musical, really. So really it was about sometimes us spending a tremendous amount of time making sure sonically we are completely getting out of the way of the visual.
But yet tying the next scene coming in. Yeah.
Well, the next scene is about a lot of things sonically, you know, and visually tied to why we stay in that vestibule is because hopefully, like I'm nervous as a viewer, what the fuck's going on? I'm in color, I'm seeing the back of her, what's happening, you know? And that's why sonically, you know, we worked a lot about not actually hearing the room until we are bold enough to go with him. And then everything gets louder as he says, I don't want to meet all these people. And he goes, you know, and so that's all. And then also the idea of where her side of the party is very sparse. And he, along with the frame, is a cacophony of male voices and noise. And so it's like, oh, sonically showing what has happened to this idyllic life that we saw in black and white. This is sonically is what's happened. It's been bifurcated. Hers is much more vacant of sound, and even in the frame, she's halfway out of the room, you know, leaning on the windowsill. Half of her body is trying to get out of the actual composition, and he instead is bombarded with all of these people and this life and this veracity for life that he later says, I'm trying, you know, he had just said, I'm reining it in. You're like, I don't know if you're reining it in, my man. You know, you know, we just heard him in black and white, Sam reining it in. Yeah. And we find out in 2 seconds that not only is he not reining in, he's getting sloppy. So that's what we were all, we were creating sonically the two different worlds. And then our relationship to that world, do we even want to walk into it? So that was a lot of fun sonically. I mean, that was like, I loved mixing that scene. That was, you know, and shooting it. That was a really wonderful exploration, that transition in their relationship to this color world and where what we were then going to explore in terms of the arc of Lenny and Felicia in the film.
And how we track with Jamie. And then we go behind the door and we are now a voyeur listening to Jamie. And
I mean, we're in that vestibule. Yeah. We're scared. Right. You know what I mean? Right. Like, we're scared the whole time
because we're dynamic, and then we get pretty quiet.
And it's not till Lenny brings us with Harry Kraut that we then we can go out. And also, that's visually the transition of we have just seen young Jamie run away through that pergola, and then older Jamie in a similar dress, similar hairstyle, now in color.
There's one thing I love that the sound of this movie, as we always say, is about rhythm, right? Very musical. The Foley from, and Vanessa, maybe you'll, or Foley artist, Vanessa I worked with back in 1982, he walks off, he tells, I'm gonna go and do what I gotta do, right? When he's with Shirley Bernstein.
Right.
So he walks off, the Foley.
He's specific about what he's gonna do.
Right, exactly.
Right. But thank you. Yes.
But his Foley, its feet, rhythm, bump, 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 and then Jamie running in.
Exactly.
It's a beautiful, it's beautiful transition.
Yeah, yeah. Foley. Yeah. Which is right, you know, that's all over this film.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everything is in service of musicality.
That's right. Everything. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is my man, the cleaner. I mean, so Gary Hart, that movie about Gary Hart that Steve Morrow did with Hugh Jackman, I remember seeing that and I thought, wow, this looks like everybody's talking. And I asked Steve about it and he said, yeah, I lob mic everybody, mix it on the day so you have something to work with in the editing room. But no one's miming. And so we did that with A Star Is Born, and we did that here, and we were able actually to write to that in the movie, because, you know, there's so much overlapping dialogue. Because to me, that's the key, you know. It's just invaluable. It's an invaluable asset, tool that I will never abandon. And we're all aware of that. So we know what's going to happen and what that's going to entail.
Yeah, but it gives you such an authenticity. No,
I mean, it's the greatest, you know, I think.
Doesn't mean it's easy.
Yeah,
to
it's not. It's hard. it's hard. But you know, and in many of the early, you know, iterations of the film, most people say, "I can't hear what they're saying. I can't hear," and you just go, "It's okay." You know, the first half of people watching edits, no one can understand what anybody's saying. But I don't care, because I know eventually we're going to understand. We're going to choose what we want, and we can highlight. So we do have, obviously, we do have the access. It's the materials there. It takes a tremendous amount of work, but it can be unearthed and focused and cleaned up and then highlighted.
On the production side, you know, a scene like this is about, you know, having a lot of mics and miking both, you know, all the principal actors and nearby, you know, key people, and then a few plant mics that are in the room to pick up.
A lot of extras lob mic'd in this. A lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the trick is on the post side is that, you know, a lot of those mics, you know, I mean, a lav mic is an omnidirectional mic, so it's picking up everybody all over and not necessarily in a good way, because they may be too far away and it's a weird thing in there. So it's really a time-consuming weaving of finding the parts you can and can't use. You know, so I'm looking through all the tracks that are recorded from that and provided to me to figure out, okay, this is Lenny and he's talking to Tommy or whoever he's talking to. And sometimes, you know, if they're this close to each other, it might be that, you know, your mic is picking me up better than mine is. And so, you know, or in a richer way. So, you know, shifting back and forth to fix those things. And if, say, you know, in this case, Jason's mic's picking up our conversation and he says something, if we're all over his mic, I can't pan him off over here because it's going to also pull us. And so, you know, it's really a sifting of trying to figure out where you can and can't get away with it. And then there's a lot of sort of sleight of hand, I guess, almost to it, to making you think that's happening when maybe it's not quite happening at the, you know.
I mean, I guess the other thing is that there wasn't, like, it wasn't just sort of this buckshot, everybody say whatever you want. It is these pockets of story that I'm exploring within three actors. You know, her at the windowsill wanted to get the Joan of Arc in there, talking about Harry Crowell, talking about her, not sharing about all that stuff. That's its own conversation that three people are having that we're getting at one time. So that's all gonna work. His conversation with Harry Crowell and Tommy, that's all scripted, all having at the same time. So I don't mind if I'm hearing other things that other people are saying, because Steve Morrow, the on-set mixer, is mixing it all, knowing that these are the things that we're exploring. So I think that was very helpful. So right away, we had a roadmap right away.
It was fun to see Tom mix this, because it was like weaving a rug. You know, it's like you want this line or these words to poke out, but you don't want these. And it was really a beautiful kind of musical, like braiding, you know, it was like braiding.
But there was, again, preparation.
Yeah.
I can't speak enough about preparation. The composition of all of these hands in the foreground and drinks, yet we're watching Lenny in the background with his sister talking, that was always designed that I wanted to hear this cacophony of male lower voices, but we're hearing them. So Steve Morrow was aware of that on the day as the sound mixer. So that was, you know, that was being recorded because it was being filmed that way. So that, again, is very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Like in the background people in that scene, were they modulating the level of their voices?
No, he was mixing it.
He was mixing it like
because
that.
He knew what I wanted.
Right.
Yeah. No, there was no modulation. That's the whole point. I want everybody to be free, mm-hmm. and it's a party. Mm-hmm. And we've mic'd it, and we're mixing it in real time.
Right.
Based on what the script is and what I want to explore.
Which makes it feel so real, because it was a party.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So and that way you can invite actors in, and I don't say action, and it's like, you know, I spent 2.5 hours or however long with composing the shot, making the camera movements, for example, that party, and then inviting everybody in and just starting. And that's how you get people, I think, that are just showing their souls and not even really aware of what they're doing.
So perspective ends up becoming a big part of making
Massive. That
work.
Massive.
You know, that's why the vestibule, the different rooms, those perspective shifts really emulate their
And that's stuff we did in here. That's not stuff it was worth talking about on set. That's about, and sometimes you come to that later too. It's like, I know I want to be in here because I'm afraid as an audience member, and I want the camera to be in here. Also, because later there's the joke about Snoopy, you know, when his ego's left in the vestibule. And then it's out there, you know, in the parade. But anyway.
If we look at another clip.
Yeah, let's do.
So the rumors aren't true.
No, darling.
Thank you. Come in to talk to me. I'm relieved.
So, yeah, that's fun. That really took forever. It did. Yeah, it's like, watch this, like, Jesus Christ.
I have to say, I don't think I ever told you this. I was so freaked out dubbing that scene, because we're just hanging out there.
Mm.
That scene is so hard to mix without overplaying.
Mm.
But I can't get in the way of the performance.
Mm.
And that's what's, I love that scene.
You know, I'm always pointing out about Dean's work is that great dialogue. For the dialogue to sound great, most people don't think about that the effects have to support it perfectly. It's not just about the dialogue. You know, if the dialogue were hanging out there by itself, you'd be like, this is weird. If the other stuff's clobbering it, you're like, this is weird. If it's not all right, it's not right. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, this is like the detail of this world we're sitting in for this very intimate, you know, difficult conversation is so perfect and it's so detailed that, I mean, it feels like you're actually sitting out there on the step.
And the composition, you know, it does have to be, everything has to be just perfect. Or mm-hmm.
And the bird placements. We spent an enormous amount of time.
I mean, it goes back to what we were talking about of goes, it's my Philly accent, goes back to... Yeah. the idea of this movie is symphonic. You know, what I see, what I hear when I watch that is just all of the work we did, you know, painstaking work of every beat, every note of wind and leaf and everything and grass. And when we wanted to underplay it so that we're with him and then we can step away from him. And yeah, I mean, it's just musical and we just spent a tremendous amount of time. Also, it originally started because I actually wasn't, you know, his voice is so strong and it's where the lob mic was on me. You know, I found that this scene and then the scene when he's interviewed by John Gruen, I found myself overwhelmed by his voice. It was too much for me. It just was very in front of everything. And I talked about that early on. And I was like, we have to try to undercut it. Because I just feel like and by the way, we dealt with that with Jackson Maine as well in mm-hmm. A Star Is Born. Like his voice, there was something about lowering that register and it becoming, it just, I didn't want it to overpower everything. And so it was about finding that balance, especially in this scene, of creating an ambient sound of the, thank goodness we have this wonderful pastoral visual landscape that is at our disposal. Yeah. And we talked about that a lot too. I was like, guys, we have all of this visual, a sonic material, right, that we need to utilize for through the whole movie. And that was something we talked about early on, you know, and every time we see something, let's use it musically. And the best part was when, which was just like, again, like Lenny and Felicia, was when he says, I'm sad, darling, and I don't know why. And at that moment, there was this huge gust of wind that came from the trees. And then we just had a field day with that. That was like, I couldn't wait to mix that. I remember when it happened, I was like, this is nuts. Dean's going to be so excited. Truly, I was thinking about that. We got something to work with. So that's just, I just look back at that scene we just watched, and it was just so delicate. Yeah, because it does hang there. But to me, that's the whole movie. He doesn't want to lie. He is not somebody who lies. That's why part of why I thought this was an interesting story to tell. It's not about an adulterer husband and a relationship where he's the guy that plays bongos on David Oppenheim, and he dances with young William, and he's only lying because his wife is telling him to. But he really wants his daughter. Why wouldn't she understand what's happening and why what they've agreed upon? And then when she says she's relieved, he's like, she's relieved. Why is she relieved? You know. And so that's what the whole movie's about, is that scene in many ways. So it was just about how can we create sonically a way to stay in it without being taken out. And that was about, you know, again, just all of us always never giving up.
And to your point, I love how you work, because we'll mix a scene and then we'll play back a scene and we're in it. And if any slight something happens that takes us out of the scene, we stop. And then we start to analyze why we did not stay with them.
That's right, always.
And we dissect, and we find out it could have been a cicada.
Oh yeah, spot, happened all the time.
Yeah, or just whatever, or a breath not loud enough.
That's right, yeah.
And then we go back and we remix the scene.
Yeah, where is it? No, sir. And then they're like, then we find the track and there it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, like detectives.
Whatever took us out of from watching the scene, we dove in to find out.
And I find that it's arduous work, as we all know, but like if you do it and you could clean it all up, the result is one fluid piece, which
Absolutely.
Is wonderful.
Yeah.
Then you can really make music.
Mm-hmm. Oh, beautiful. Love it.
So I think our big finale piece.
The thing I'll say about this is because we recorded it live, and we over 2 days, and we did it, and we had set up mics the first day when there was no cameras to get as many, you know, as much, right? How many extra mics did we put before we started doing the cameras?
A lot.
A lot.
Yeah.
And then once they started playing it again live, but we wanted to have it as many channels as possible. But they're so good, the London Symphony Orchestra, they could just do it the same. It's just unbelievable to watch a machine like that work. I mean, it's just like mind-blowing. But they kept saying, their manager kept saying, Mario was like, you know, we can't play it that loud anymore, remember?
Right.
These DBs are like, we can't go for their ears. We're like, oh, yeah, of course, of course. They never played it lower. No. They couldn't help themselves. No. Every time I was like, I couldn't hear. They're like, you know, it was hilarious. Like every time they were like, fuck it.
The LSO comes standard with a couple people with meters that they're constantly monitoring.
Yeah, constantly, you know, to make sure that it wasn't, because it was so loud.
Especially
and it's depending on, you know, they were right next to the timpani, you know what I mean, and the brass is right behind them, you know, there was no glass or plastic in between, you know. They were so invested, by the end, it was really, and it's why we went back and had that's who recorded all of the music. I was sort of adamant that they were such a part of the fabric of the film at that point after those 2 days together. Because it didn't have to go that way at all. It could have gone south.
I mean, it was all in the prep. The prep was
massive,
literally years, kind of how we were going to do this. And there was, you know, you look at the textbook stuff, it's like, well, you know, I mean, Bradley, since Star is Born, he's like, we're going to do the whole thing live. And it was kind of horrifying and exciting at the same time. It's like, you know, risk is kind of the only word that comes to mind. And you know, there were, through budget conversations or whatever, it's like, well, what if we pre-record the strings and just get the chorus and the soloist live? And how, you know, that sort of safety net of how much can we control this recording? And we got down to it. It's like, let's go for it. We really didn't have to comp because of the beautiful oneer that we got, you know, with Brad. I mean, we were so excited when we left. I knew it was going to be great. I had no idea he was going to pull that off. And there were, you know, in the script, if I can say
that. We thought it was going to be comped based on how I had set up shots the first day. This is really like a miraculous thing that occurred.
Yeah.
There was a massive cable cam shot that was really going to focus only on her, which I really just did out of fear because I thought there's no version where I'm going to do this without messing it up. And really, truly, but we'd already done the Fairfield, the East Hampton, and I had rethought how I wanted her to receive her guests. And that was that shot of us having to sit with her now, having suffered from the effects of chemotherapy. And that was that shot. So I knew already I was fucked because I already used that. But I sort of didn't tell myself. I was like, okay. So I went into it already filled with fear. And we had like three cameras, which we never had in this movie, except for the first day of shooting, which I shot out of fear, which was him teaching young William, which I always wanted it to be that wonder, which is what's in the movie, but I had done a bunch of setups out of fear again. And in that, we had it, and we thought we could comp it, and we could do whatever we wanted, because it was really a cable cam shot. You know that first wide of this? That was the beginning of a cable cam shot that I just used as a static, as an establishing instead. But we came back the next day, we brought in a techno crane, and I said, we have to try to do it in one. And that's when it happened. The whole point was, you know, can we conduct this 6.5 minutes of music and film it so that you believe what everybody's been saying the whole movie about this guy being able to stand in the center of the sun and have the music of Mahler shine through him to us. I mean, that's why you understand why she stays with this guy. And why she says there's no hate in your heart. There's no hate in that guy's heart. Instead, he's, you know, he's up there in the clouds where we brought him down at the beginning of the movie. You know, that was the hope. It had to be one organism. That was why it's a 27 millimeter lens. And we see his close-up, but it was all about seeing him and the orchestra together moving as one organism to the music. And this London Symphony Orchestra, about five of the choral members had played with Leonard Bernstein in the 80s. The harpist teacher was the harpist for this recording that's on YouTube. If you go to YouTube, you could watch this that he did in Ely Cathedral with the London Symphony Orchestra in the 70s. So there, and we were shooting it there. So it was very exciting for everybody, you know, and because I had done enough work there, I believed I was Leonard Bernstein. So there was I think that they were seeing this guy that kind of looked like Leonard Bernstein talking to them. So I think everybody, at least they made me believe that we were all believing this illusion. And so it felt very special. We left that cathedral and it felt like something had happened there. Yeah.
It really did. I think we over-prepped because there was some magic. I mean, when we even looked down to what sheet music are we putting on the stand, I mean, we were able to go back through libraries and find bowings that were still handwritten from so, you know, so every authentic piece was brought to the table, but it was really the magic that really, you know, just the wonder where it just like, I don't even know how to describe it.
You know, there's moments in your life where you're like, it's okay that you messed up. This one would not have been okay. My point is, if the movie all of a sudden you get to the scene and it's very heavily edited, the movie wouldn't have, it wouldn't have, yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.